Hello everyone, today we discuss the forceful detention and possible cultural genocide of Uyghur Muslims in Xinjiang province of China. The Xinjiang Autonomous Region in China's far west has had a long history of discord between the authorities and the indigenous ethnic Uyghur population. The largest of China's administrative regions, Xinjiang takes up 1/6 of China's landmass and borders 8 countries including Mongolia, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India. The region has had intermittent autonomy and occasional independence, but what is now known as Xinjiang came under Chinese rule in the 18th century. An East Turkestan state was briefly declared in 1949, but independence was short-lived, and later that year it became officially part of Communist China. The region's economy has largely revolved around agriculture and trade, and towns such as Kashgar thriving as hubs, along the famous Silk Road that had been an important trade route between Europe through Central Asia to China in ancient times. Until recently, its population was mostly Uyghur, a predominantly Muslim ethnic minority that speaks a language closely related to Turkish and have their own distinct culture. Some Uyghurs living there refer to the region as East Turkestan and argue that it ought to be independent from China. While the situation in Xinjiang is complex, ethnic tensions caused by economic and cultural factors have been cited as a root cause of dissent among the Uyghurs there. Major development projects in the last decade have brought prosperity to the big cities, attracting young and technically qualified Han Chinese from eastern provinces. The heavily industrialized capital Urumqi has a population of more than 2.3 million, about 75% of whom are Han, including large number of troops stationed in the region and unknown numbers of unregistered migrants. Uyghurs have been reduced to 12.8% and 10% are from other ethnic groups. Thus, Uyghurs, who had been the majority in the region, now account for just under half of Xinjiang's total population, and many of them live in the southern rural part of the region. The Han Chinese are said to be given the best jobs and the majority do well economically, something that has fueled resentment among Uyghurs. Further, Uyghurs and the mostly Han government disagree on which group has greater historical claim to the Xinjiang region. Uyghurs believe their ancestors were indigenous to the area, but according to the Chinese policy, Uyghurs are classified as a national minority. They are considered to be no more indigenous to Xinjiang than the Han and have no special rights to the land under the law. Chinese government's paranoia and oppression in Xinjiang has had a long history. In the 1930s and 40s, Xinjiang experienced brief periods of partial independence when two breakaway East Turkestan republics were declared and swiftly put down. Today, Uyghur activists pushing for Xinjiang to become a separate country still call it East Turkestan. Uyghurs and other minorities in Xinjiang have long complained of discrimination in employment and education, and corruption is rife within state-controlled industries that continue to dominate the local. Uyghur activists and right groups claim that China's repression of religious freedom and unfair ethnic policies is at the root of the conflicts, while China has blamed Islamist militants and separatists for the violent attacks. China has been accused of intensifying its crackdown on the Uyghurs after the street protests in the 1990s. However, the turning point in Beijing's attitude towards Uyghurs came in 2009, when ethnic riots in Xinjiang's capital Urumqi broke out as mostly Uyghur demonstrators protested against state-incentivized Han Chinese migration in the region and widespread economic and cultural discrimination, in which nearly 200 people were killed. Further, there have been violent incidents in June 2012, in April and June 2013, in May and September 2014, which the Chinese government accredited to terrorist actions. Some violence has also spilled out of Xinjiang. A mass stabbing spree in Kunming in Yunnan province that killed 29 people was blamed on Xinjiang separatists, as well as an October 2013 incident where a car plowed into a crowd and burst into flames in Beijing's Tiananmen Square. In response to the slew of attacks, the authorities stepped up security in Xinjiang and conducted more military drills in the region. There had also been reports of mass sentencings and arrests of several terror groups. Chinese state media had reported long lists of people convicted of extremist activity and in some cases death sentences. China has often blamed ETIM, the East Turkestan Islamic Movement, or people inspired by ETIM for violent incidents both in Xinjiang and beyond the region's borders. ETIM is said to want to establish an independent East Turkestan in China. However, the scope of ETIM's activities remains unclear, with some questioning the group's capacity to organize such serious acts of extremism. Whatsoever, Chinese government set up the detention camps for Uyghurs with the aim of eliminating threats to China's territorial integrity, government and population from the terrorist organizations like East Turkestan Islamic Movement. Following the 9/11 attacks, the Chinese government started justifying its actions towards Uyghurs as part of the global war on terrorism. It said it would combat what it calls the three evils, that is separatism, religious extremism and international terrorism, at all costs. The President Xi Jinping of China warned of the toxicity of religious extremism and advocated for using the tools of dictatorship to eliminate Islamist extremism in a series of secret speeches while visiting Xinjiang in 2014. In the speeches revealed by the New York Times in November 2019, Xi did not explicitly call for arbitrary detention, but laid the groundwork for the crackdown in Xinjiang. Further, arbitrary detention became widely used by regional officials under Chen Quangco, Xinjiang's Communist Party secretary, who moved to the region in 2016 after holding a top leadership position in Tibet. Known for increasing the number of police and security checkpoints, as well as state control over Buddhist monasteries in Tibet, Chen has since dramatically intensified security in Xinjiang. He repeatedly called on officials to round up everyone who should be rounded up, according to the New York Times report. In March 2017, Xinjiang's government passed an anti-extremism law that prohibited people from growing long beards and wearing veils in public. It also officially recognized the use of training centers to eliminate extremism. According to experts and government officials, some 800,000 to 2 million Uyghurs and other Muslims, including ethnic Kazakhs and Uzbeks, have been detained since April 2017. Outside of the camps, the 11 million Uyghurs living in Xinjiang have continued to suffer from a decade-long crackdown by Chinese authorities. Most people in the camps have never been charged with crimes and have no legal avenues to challenge their detentions. According to reports, the detainees seem to have been targeted for a variety of reasons, including traveling to or contacting people from any of the 26 countries China considers sensitive, such as Turkey and Afghanistan, attending services at mosques, having more than three children, and sending texts containing Quranic verses. Human rights groups say many Uyghurs have been labeled as extremists simply for practicing their religion. Experts estimate that Xinjiang re-education efforts started in 2014 and were drastically expanded in 2017. Reuters journalist observing satellite imagery found that 39 of the camps almost tripled in size between April 2017 and August 2018. Information on what actually happens in the camps is limited, but many detainees who have since fled China describe harsh conditions. Detainees are forced to pledge loyalty to the CCP and renounce Islam, they say, as well as sing praises for communism and learn Mandarin. Some reported prison-like conditions with cameras and microphones monitoring their every move and utterance. Others said they were tortured and subjected to sleep deprivation during interrogations. Women have shared stories of sexual abuse, with some saying they were forced to undergo abortions or have contraceptive devices implanted against their will. Some released detainees contemplated suicide or witnessed others kill themselves. Detention also disrupts families. Children whose parents have been sent to the camps are often forced to stay in state-run orphanages. Uyghur parents living outside of China often face a difficult choice: return home to be with their children and risk detention, or stay abroad separated from their children and unable to contact them. Though China's crackdown on Xinjiang echoes a long-time paranoia about the frontier region and a deep suspicion of its non-Han population among China's rulers, recently economic factors are also involved. In the current times, Xinjiang is an important link in China's Belt and Road Initiative, a massive development plan stretching through Asia and Europe. Beijing hopes to eradicate any possibility of separatist activity to continue its development of Xinjiang, which is home to China's largest coal and natural gas reserves. Human rights organizations have observed that the economic benefits of resource extraction and development are often disproportionately enjoyed by Han Chinese, and Uyghur people are increasingly marginalized. Many people who were arbitrarily detained have been forced to work in factories close to the detention camps, according to multiple reports. The Australian Strategic Policy Institute estimates that since 2017, 80,000 previously detained Uyghurs have been sent to factories throughout China linked to 83 global brands. Researchers from the Center for Strategic and International Studies say forced labor is an important element of the government's plan for Xinjiang's economic development, which includes making it a hub of textile and apparel manufacturing. Chinese officials have described the policy as poverty alleviation. As far as Chinese response to all these allegations are concerned, government officials first denied the camps' existence. Starting in October 2018, however, officials started calling them centers for vocational education and training programs. Chinese officials publicly maintain that the camps have two purposes: to teach Mandarin, Chinese laws, and vocational skills, and to prevent citizens from becoming influenced by extremist ideas so as to nip terrorist activities in the bud. Officials claim the camps have prevented violence, pointing out that Xinjiang has not experienced a terrorist attack since December 2016. The Chinese government has resisted international pressure to allow in outside investigators, saying anything happening inside Xinjiang is an internal issue. It denies that people are forced to denounce Islam, are detained against their will, and experience abuse in the camps. In early 2019, it organized several trips for foreign diplomats to visit Xinjiang, which a US official criticized as highly choreographed. In October 2018 and December 2019, Chinese state media aired two documentaries at home on the conflict and the purported necessity of the camps, which reportedly drew mixed reactions on Chinese social media. Even before these camps became a major part of the Chinese government's anti-extremism campaign, the government was accused of cracking down on religious freedom and basic human rights in Xinjiang. Experts say that the entire province has been turned into a surveillance state that relies on cutting-edge technology to monitor millions of people. Under the Xinjiang's Communist Party leader Shen, it was placed under a grid management system, as described in media reports, in which cities and villages were split into squares of about 500 people. Each square has a police station that closely monitors inhabitants by regularly scanning their identification cards, taking their photographs and fingerprints, and searching their cell phones. In some cities, such as Kashgar, police checkpoints are found every 100 yards or so, and facial recognition cameras are everywhere. The government also collects and stores citizens' biometric data through a required program advertised as Physicals for All. Much of that information is collected into a massive database known as the Integrated Joint Operations Platform, which then uses artificial intelligence to create lists of so-called suspicious people. Classified Chinese government documents released by the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists, ICIJ, in November 2019 revealed that more than 15,000 Xinjiang residents were placed in detention centers during a 7-day period in June 2017 after being flagged by the algorithm. The Chinese government, however, called the leaked documents pure fabrication and maintained that the camps are education and training centers. The documents, together with other first-hand reports, paint an alarming picture of what appears to be a strategic campaign by Beijing to strip Uyghurs of their cultural and religious identity and suppress behavior considered to be unpatriotic. Communist Party members have been recruited since 2014 to stay in Uyghur homes and report on any perceived extremist behaviors, including fasting during Ramadan. Officials have destroyed mosques, claiming the buildings were shoddily constructed and unsafe for worshippers. Uyghur parents are banned from giving their babies certain names, including Muhammad and Medina. Halal food, which is prepared according to Islamic law, has become harder to find in Urumqi as the local government has launched a campaign against it. China has also pressurized other governments to repatriate Uyghurs who have fled the country. For example, in 2015, Thailand returned more than 100 Uyghurs, and in 2017, Egypt deported several students. The documents released by ICIJ recently showed that the Chinese government instructed officials to collect information on Chinese Uyghurs living abroad and called for many to be arrested as soon as they re-entered China. As far as the global response against this Chinese tyranny is concerned, much of the world has condemned China's detention of Uyghurs in Xinjiang. The UN Human Rights Chief and other UN officials have demanded access to the camps. The European Union has called on China to respect religious freedom and change its policies in Xinjiang. And human rights organizations have urged China to immediately shut down the camps and answer questions about disappeared Uyghurs. However, notably silent are many Muslim nations. Prioritizing their economic ties and strategic relations with China, many governments have ignored the human rights abuses by China. Earlier in 2019, Turkey became the only Muslim-majority country to voice concern when its foreign minister called on China to ensure the full protection of the cultural identities of the Uyghurs and other Muslims during a UN Human Rights Council session. In July 2019, 22 Western countries and Japan had written to the UN Human Rights Council to criticize China on the Uyghur issue. However, 50 countries, many of them Muslim countries, wrote a joint letter to the President of the UN Human Rights Council and the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights to defend China against this accusation and praise China's remarkable achievements in human rights and its counter-terrorism efforts in Xinjiang. In October 2019, the US imposed visa restrictions on Chinese officials believed to be responsible for or complicit in the detention of Muslims in Xinjiang. It also blacklisted more than 24 Chinese companies and agencies linked to abuses in the region, including surveillance technology manufacturers and Xinjiang's Public Security Bureau, effectively blocking them from buying US products. In June 2020, President Trump signed legislation passed with overwhelming support from Congress, mandating that individuals, including Communist Party Secretary Chen, face sanctions for oppressing Uyghurs. This is the first time such sanctions have been imposed on a member of China's Politburo. The law also requires that US businesses and individuals selling products to or operating in Xinjiang ensure their activities don't contribute to human rights violations, including the use of forced labor. Human Rights Watch has advocated other actions the US and other countries could take, including publicly challenging Xi Jinping, denying exports of technologies that facilitate the abuse, pressing China to allow UN investigators in Xinjiang, and preventing China from targeting members of the Uyghur diaspora. Further, as far as the reports in 2020 are concerned, there are shocking revelations of a possible cultural genocide of Uyghurs by birth control measures in Xinjiang by China. Comprehensive new evidence from government documents reveals a systematic state campaign of suppressing minority births while simultaneously encouraging a mass influx of new Han Chinese workers and settlers. In the two counties, Houghton and Guma in Xinjiang, predominantly home to members of the Uyghur ethnic minority, it has been planned to sterilize approximately 14-34% of women between 18-49 years of age in a single year. Per capita, that represents more sterilization than China performed in the 20 years between 1998 and 2018 combined. Documents from Xinjiang's Health Commission indicate that this is part of a wider project targeting all of the province's southern minority regions in 2019 and 2020. Since 2017, up to 1.8 million Uyghurs, Kazakhs and other Turkic minority groups in Xinjiang have been swept up in what is probably the largest incarceration of an ethno-religious minority since the Holocaust. Exile Uyghurs and China researchers have described this campaign as a cultural genocide. The new research published in July 2020 provides strong evidence that China's actions in Xinjiang also meet the physical genocide criterion cited in Section D of Article 2 of the United Nations Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide, that is, imposing measures intended to prevent births within the targeted group. According to a leaked government document called Karakak's list in February 2020, birth control violations were often the only stated reason for internment of camp detainees. It indicates a spike in the number of Uyghurs detained for birth control violations in 2018, and during precisely that time, Xinjiang's minority regions issued draconian new regulations for dealing with birth control policy violations, threatening the violators with internment. However, threatening with internment has been just one of the several strategies to suppress minority birth rates. The second approach was a mass deployment of intrauterine devices, a widely used form of birth control around the world and the most commonly used form in China. In 2018, a stunning 80% of all newly placed IUDs in China were fitted in Xinjiang, even though the region only makes up 1.8% of the country's population. The third and the most draconian birth prevention strategy, sterilizations, soon followed. In 2018, the region performed over 7 times more sterilizations per capita than the national average. Then in 2019, when a growing number of male detainees were shifted from internment camps to either prisons or forced labor compounds, the state moved towards what appears to be a campaign of mass female sterilization. This campaign is part of a project titled Free Technical Family Planning Services to Farmers and Pastoralists. The project's combined funding for 2019 and 20 amounted to 260 million renminbi, that is about $36 million on the regional level alone. As of now, there is nothing to say that this campaign will end in 2020. The government's goal in Uyghur regions is to achieve zero birth control violation incidents. Not one minority child is to be born outside the villa of the state. In contrast, in January 2016, China has already abolished its one-child policy, and it has since encouraged its citizens to have two children in order to maintain positive population growth. Moreover, Xinjiang's birth prevention tactics are just one aspect of what appears to be a strategy of ethno-racial domination. Between 2015 and 2018, 2 million new residents moved to Xinjiang, all of them belonging to the Chinese Han. The state, in fact, promotes such in-migration of Han through lucrative offers into Xinjiang. Additionally, regional authorities actively encourage inter-ethnic marriages between Han men and Uyghur women in an apparent effort to dilute Uyghur cultural identity and promote their assimilation into the Chinese nation race. To summarize, though the Chinese government claims to have released all of the 1 million arbitrarily detained Turkic Muslims, evidence suggests that some are now subjected to forced labor instead. The mass surveillance systems also tightly control the movement of Xinjiang's purportedly free residents. Some camp detainees have also disappeared into Xinjiang's vast prison system. Many relatives of the detained living abroad still have no contact with family members in the province. Thus, while Xinjiang's abuses may have shifted shape, they have not yet disappeared. If that is not enough, with the draconian birth control measures in minorities in Xinjiang, China is engaged in cultural genocide aiming at ethno-racial supremacy, a campaign that meets at least one of the 5 criteria for physical genocide specified by the UN. Experts say the situation warrants an investigation into crimes against humanity, including an assessment whether China's policies in Xinjiang are gradually progressing from cultural genocide to a form of demographic genocide. And that's all for today. Thank you.